healthy heart is not a metronome. There are fluctuations in the timing between each one of your heartbeats. This variability gives the heart flexibility, an ability to rapidly cope with an uncertain and changing environment full of different stressors.
Unlike heart rate, which measures the number of times your heart beats per minute, heart rate variability, or HRV, focuses on the variation in time intervals between consecutive heartbeats, which are known as interbeat intervals, or IBIs. HRV is a practical, non-invasive, and cost-effective way to measure the activity of the autonomic nervous system.
Our bodies are continuously readjusting to maintain a state of balance called homeostasis. Our heart rate, blood pressure, glucose level, hormones, and more react to the stressors we face, and the autonomic nervous system works to keep everything in balance so that we can function optimally. Heart rhythm, and therefore HRV, at rest is regulated by the parasympathetic nervous system. The upshot is that measuring your HRV is an effective way to capture your body's response to stress. The concept of HRV dates back to the 18th century, but key to its accurate implementation was the invention of the ECG in the 19th century. By the 1960s, HRV emerged as a useful indicator of autonomic function. This period saw the emergence of lots of different methods to quantify HRV, including time domain, frequency domain, and non-linear analyses. We'll talk about these later.
Early clinical research focused on the relationship between HRV and cardiovascular health. Studies demonstrated that reduced HRV was associated with a higher risk of adverse cardiovascular events and mortality in populations with heart disease. This backed up the idea that HRV provided a simple, non-invasive method to assess cardiovascular disease risk. HRV then began to be explored in other clinical settings.
Today, the application of HRV has expanded beyond clinical research into sports science and general wellness, particularly with the widespread adoption of wearable devices like the Apple Watch, Fitbit, and several Garmin devices, which all provide a measure of HRV. Athletes and coaches started to use HRV as a measure of training adaptation and recovery. The idea being that, by monitoring HRV, athletes can gauge their body's response to training loads and assess the recovery and prevent overtraining. And because stress, both physical and psychological, affects the balance of the autonomic nervous system, HRV has become the biometric of interest in stress management programs, mindfulness training, and mental health interventions.
The sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems work in tandem to maintain cardiac homeostasis. In simple terms, the sympathetic nervous system typically responds to stress by accelerating heart rate, while the parasympathetic nervous system promotes relaxation and recovery, decelerating heart rate. HRV reflects this balance. Higher variability generally indicates a healthy, responsive heart capable of efficiently adapting to changing environmental demands, whereas a lower HRV generally means that the heart is less adaptable.
Admittedly, this is a bit of a simplification. The relationship between the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous branches of the autonomic nervous system is complex. It is both linear and non-linear, and it shouldn't really be described as a zero-sum seesaw system. We'll delve into the nuance of what this means for interpreting HRV a little bit later, but just know that it's not a simple case of high HRV good, low HRV bad. Broadly speaking, HRV can be calculated in three ways: in the time domain, the frequency domain, or using non-linear analyses. Each method offers a different perspective on the underlying dynamics of heart rate.
Time domain analysis involves using statistical measures of the time intervals between consecutive heartbeats, which are defined by the heart's electrical signal, hence why the invention of the ECG was so important for HRV. The part of the signal used to delineate one heartbeat from another can vary, but or intervals are commonly used. Or here refers to the peak of the QRS complex of the heart's electrical signal and the interval between these peaks. Normal to normal, or NN intervals, are also used. NN intervals refer to the intervals between normal or peaks. You see, sometimes during measurement, artifacts can happen due to arrhythmic events or faulty sensors, and this can lead to abnormal or peaks, which may in turn distort the statistics of HRV measurement. To ensure reliable and valid data, normal to normal, or NN, intervals are selected to iron out messy data. In any case, common time domain metrics include the standard deviation of NN intervals, or SDNN, which is one of the simplest and most widely used HRV parameters. SDNN has a long history in research and clinical settings, having been mostly used for 24-hour measurements in patient populations. It's also the default HRV measure that the Apple Watch records. The idea is that by looking at SDNN, you can get an understanding of HRV changes throughout the day in response to, say, circadian rhythm or acute stressors. It has mainly been used to distinguish between having no variability at all versus a healthy, adaptable cardiovascular system. We'll talk about the challenges of taking 24-hour measurements of HRV later, but the main shortcoming of SDNN over the other time domain measures like RMSSD, which I'll talk about in a second, comes down to its mathematics. While most metrics tend to capture variability, SDNN only captures deviations from the mean, not high-frequency beat-to-beat changes due to vagal activity. The root mean square of the successive differences, or RMSSD, is another time domain measure. Unlike SDNN, it represents the root mean square of differences between successive normal to normal intervals. This means that RMSSD is better able to capture short-term changes in heart rhythm. There are several other advantages of RMSSD over SDNN as a measure of HRV. It's easy to calculate, values can be compared across studies, and it is time invariant, so using a shorter or longer time window still provides relatively comparable results. Another common time domain measure of HRV is PNN50, or percentage of NN50, which is calculated as the proportion of consecutive beat-to-beat intervals that differ by more than 50 milliseconds. This is intuitively the most problematic approach to measuring HRV in the time domain, as it introduces a pretty arbitrary threshold, 50 milliseconds. This kind of thresholding used to be more popular in research, as it meant you could split people easily into groups based on physiological values. The higher the variability, the higher the PNN50, but the rationale underpinning the threshold of 50 milliseconds, or any other arbitrary threshold for that matter, is not well motivated. As a result, this measure has fallen out of favour in recent years. When it comes to frequency domain analysis, the term frequency doesn't refer to the heart rate itself. It's actually a reference to the rate at which oscillations in heart rate variability occur. Essentially, we're interested in how the intervals between consecutive heartbeats, those interbeat intervals, change. These changes can be slow, fast, or somewhere in between. The frequency domain analysis of HRV is about understanding the rate at which these interbeat intervals change and the balance of the autonomic nervous system control exerted at these rates.
So there are the two kinds of linear measures of HRV. They rely on the assumption that heart rate dynamics follow a predictable linear pattern and are based on statistical and mathematical techniques that assume a regular proportional relationship between various elements of the heart rate signal. Linear methods are widely used because they are relatively straightforward to calculate and interpret, and they do provide valuable information about the overall level of HRV and the balance between the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems. Nonlinear methods, on the other hand, recognize that heart rate dynamics are not always linear or predictable. Your heart's signal can exhibit complex patterns that are not captured by traditional linear methods, which average out certain complexities. Nonlinear measures like Poincaré plot analysis, entropy measures, and detrended fluctuation analysis can reveal aspects of heart rate variability that linear methods miss. For example, they might detect subtle changes in autonomic function or uncover the presence of chaotic, irregular patterns in heart rate dynamics that could be indicative of certain health conditions. But the complexity of nonlinear methods makes them more challenging to interpret. You need to have specialized knowledge in mathematical and computational techniques, and the results can be less intuitive than those of linear methods. This means that nonlinear measures are more commonly used in advanced research settings rather than in clinical practice or consumer health applications. So we've talked about the methods of analysis, but not how to take a measurement of HRV. This is vital because HRV is really sensitive to different environmental or contextual factors. This means that if you don't follow a consistent protocol and measure your HRV at the right times, the measurement isn't going to mean much, regardless of whether you use the time domain, frequency domain, or nonlinear methods of analysis.
Essentially, there are three approaches to taking a HRV measurement. You can monitor your HRV over a full 24-hour period, over a short-term period, typically around 5 minutes, or over what's known as an ultra-short-term period, which is less than 5 minutes. Regardless of whether you're taking a 24-hour, a short-term, or an ultra-short-term period, though, there are a few general principles that need to be followed when measuring HRV. First, it's important to ensure consistency in the measurement conditions. For HRV to be a reliable indicator, it should be measured under similar physiological and environmental conditions each time. This means taking measurements at the same time of day, ideally in a rested state, like immediately after waking up or after sitting quietly for a few minutes. This helps to minimize the influence of external factors like physical activity, mental stress, caffeine, or meal timing, which can all significantly impact HRV readings. Second, your posture during measurement plays a significant role. Generally speaking, it's recommended to maintain a consistent posture, usually lying down or sitting, during each measurement session, and this shouldn't be changed during serial measures that you plan to compare HRV values over. Third, because breathing patterns are known to have a big influence on HRV, your breathing should either be controlled during serial measures or you should just breathe naturally without any consideration of your respiratory rate. Which approach to take here is the subject of ongoing debate. The main thing is that you should consider which is the most appropriate and stick with it. Don't mingle HRV measures where the breathing is controlled with those where it's not. Fourth, the duration of the measurement needs to be consistent. While 24-hour monitoring provides a comprehensive overview of HRV across different states, it requires sophisticated equipment and is mostly used in clinical research settings. It's also prone to contextual factors that might make the readings meaningless. Short-term and ultra-short-term measurements, in contrast, are more practical for daily monitoring and are commonly used in both clinical settings and for personal health tracking. Lastly, your choice of which HRV metrics and the analysis methods you use should align with the measurement duration and the specific goals of monitoring. For short-term and ultra-short-term measurements, time domain measures like RMSSD and SDNN are popular because of their simplicity and ease of interpretation. Frequency domain measures can provide additional insights but require longer recording durations and more complex analysis, making them more suitable for research or clinical use. And lastly, because they are so complex, nonlinear metrics, even though they can offer a unique perspective on heart rate dynamics, are typically only used for specialized research because of their complexity.
Your HRV is unique to you. While it's true that higher HRVs are generally considered to be healthier because they reflect a kind of autonomic flexibility, lots of factors can have a big impact on your HRV. This means that what constitutes a high or low HRV can vary significantly. When it comes to interpreting HRV then, more important than absolute values are changes and trends over time. As a brief recap, HRV typically decreases as the heart beats more rhythmically, reflecting an acute stress response and sympathetic nervous system activation. But over time, regular exercise tends to increase HRV at rest, and this is indicative of a healthy, resilient heart and a well-balanced autonomic nervous system. The takeaway when it comes to interpretation is that HRV can't be boiled down to absolute rules. After intense training blocks, for example, an overactive parasympathetic nervous system response might elevate your HRV. You could interpret this as a positive sign of having achieved a balance between your sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, indicating an appropriate training response, but it could also suggest a need for recovery if the parasympathetic nervous system is working overtime to counteract stress. In other words, you might interpret your high HRV as meaning that you are well rested, when in actuality, it's high because your parasympathetic nervous system is working really hard to recover from the training block. With this in mind, generally speaking, while each person's HRV is unique, higher values generally indicate better autonomic balance and adaptability. Factors that can increase your HRV include exercise, positive emotions, and certain dietary habits, whereas stress, negative emotions, alcohol, caffeine, and poor diet can decrease HRV. Unlike resting heart rate, where lower rates are typically healthier, HRV values are more individualized and trends over time are more informative than absolute values. Recently, many consumer wearable devices have come to rely on HRV to provide users with an idea of their readiness. Garmin, Oura, Whoop and Fitbit all have some variation of a readiness score that is largely derived from HRV. The core technology behind these wearables is photoplethysmography, or PPG for short. The catch with PPG is that it only works well when you're completely still. Any movement can throw off readings significantly. Even doing something like typing or flexing a muscle in your wrist, and suddenly your HRV data is triple what it should be. That's why continuous monitoring with wrist-worn wearables can produce inaccurate data. They're prone to errors from everyday movements and physiological factors like ectopic beats, which are more common than you might think. When it comes to accuracy, chest straps are better. They measure the heart's electrical activity and are less sensitive to motion. But this raises the important difference between HRV and pulse rate variability, or PRV. HRV is all about the heart's beats, while PRV is what something like the Apple Watch or Oura Ring measure. It's concerned with pulse rate changes. This distinction is actually pretty complex, and we don't really have the time to get into it, but even things like your blood pressure can affect your PRV. This is one of the reasons why, if you're using a wearable device, and therefore PPG, to measure your heart rate variability, you're better off taking a measure in a very controlled setting, like first thing in the morning after you wake up, rather than throughout the day.
If you wanted to take a manual HRV measurement with your wearable device, you could follow these steps. Once you wake up, if you need to, visit the bathroom first, then either in a lying or sitting position, measure your HRV for between 1 and 5 minutes. Remember, be consistent. If you're taking serial measures over days, weeks, or months, follow the same protocol. Don't change the time frame and don't lie down for some and sit for others. Some researchers even argue that taking a HRV measure sitting up is better because the orthostatic stressor it induces makes the data more sensitive, effectively capturing your body's stress response. You probably won't have a choice when it comes to the specific statistical method that your wearable device uses, but most measure HRV using time domain outcomes like RMSSD.
When it comes to HRV, you need to recognize that normal is better. Stability is what you should be aiming for. This personal frame of reference allows you to compare daily measurements or your weekly baseline to understand when you're under more stress than usual. By focusing on relative changes over time rather than absolute values, you can better identify periods of higher or lower stress and adjust your lifestyle or training accordingly. For example, if your HRV today is lower than yesterday's, it might indicate increased stress, suggesting a need to limit additional stressors to avoid negative chronic responses like burnout or overtraining. A key principle of HRV-guided training is to limit stress on days when HRV is suppressed. This approach isn't about avoiding stress, but rather managing it more adeptly. A stable HRV indicates a positive response to high stress, suggesting well-developed fitness and the ability to recover quickly from intense stressors. Conversely, a dip in HRV signals a negative response, often due to a mismatch between the stressor and our current capacity to handle it. This could be either an overly challenging stimulus or the impact of non-training related stressors like lifestyle changes or psychological stress.
To analyze HRV stability, we can use the coefficient of variation, which measures day-to-day variability in HRV scores. This measure differs from the baseline, which is an average of your scores over a past period. For example, if your baseline HRV is 60 milliseconds and your daily scores are consistently around this number, your coefficient of variation will be small, indicating stability. However, if your daily scores fluctuate widely, the coefficient of variation will be large, suggesting less stability. This variability, combined with baseline changes, can offer insights to how well you adapt to training and other stressors.